All right, internal controls. So as you know, with the passage of Sarbanes-Oxley, internal controls became a bigger part of the audit process for auditors. Not that auditors did not look at internal controls prior to SOX, however, it wasn't mandated. So it was the auditor's auditor's discretion as to what level of internal controls they would look at. They didn't have to issue a report on internal controls prior to SOX. Most times, what they did was really internal controls, again, they did use to determine the extent of testing, but it wasn't required that they had to test internal controls and report on internal controls as mandated by SOX. Also mandated by SOX is that management has to issue a report on internal controls. So as a result of that, internal controls took on a much bigger part or role in the audit process. So if you think back to the audit risk model, one component of the risk model is control risk assessment. Right? The auditors have to assess control risk. And their assessment of internal control risk, along with their assessment of inherent risk, is going to impact the amount of audit evidence that they collect. So if they can rely on internal controls and they see that internal controls are highly effective, they can decrease their testing in those areas where internal controls are extremely effective. And likewise, if it's not effective, then they have to increase their testing. So what is controls? It's a process. It's a process that's designed by management. Just like the financial statements are the responsibility of management, internal controls are the responsibility of management. And it's not the auditor's responsibility to come in and design the internal controls for a company. Why? Why would that be a problem? Right, you'd be testing your own work, and that violates what?
Independence.
Oh, so we do remember something from the first exam, right? So the auditors can't go in and do that. And management, it's management's responsibility. It's their organization. They understand their organization better than auditors. So they want to make sure that internal controls are effective prior to the auditors coming in. They don't want the auditors to have to find problems with internal controls because they realize it's going to impact the amount of reliance the auditor can place on internal controls, and then it's going to impact the amount of evidence and extend audit procedures if they can't rely on it. So it's a process, and so much like we've learned today, it's a judgment process, right? It is no correct answers are really rare. I mean, clearly you would expect that if you ship goods, you'd want to see a shipping document, some form of shipping document. But some of it, a lot of it is a judgment process. Just think about the internal control risk assessment. It's a judgment process that the auditor makes. Quite possibly I know some people emailed me that when they were going through this part of the Pinnacle case, that they had differences with their team. They thought one thing and the team thought another thing in terms of how you would assess internal controls, right? So it is a judgment process. It is also what management is trying to do with an effective system of internal controls is safeguard their assets. Right? You want to know that your internal controls are in place to prevent or detect errors or irregularities. You want it to prevent or detect. You don't have an effective system of internal controls if it cannot do that. We'll talk about a little later about preventive controls versus detective controls. The importance of internal controls is related to the reliability of the financial statement. So think about it. What do we say when an auditor gives an opinion? What they're looking for is to ensure that the financial statements are free of material misstatements. They have to be able to rely on that. Think about some of the assertions that management makes about the financial statements that the auditors are testing. Okay? So they want to be able to rely on the information that's in the financial statement. And for reporting purposes, auditors will issue an integrated report that consists of a report on internal controls as well as a report on the financial statement. Also, from a management perspective, it promotes operational efficiency. So you want your internal controls to be communicated to the organization, employees in the organization, so that they understand how things should work, how it's supposed to work. You don't want the same transaction happening 15 different ways. So Division B handles transactions this way, Division C handles it another way. It has to be consistent because it becomes efficient that way, especially from an audit perspective. To know that the internal controls are operating effectively throughout the organization is important. Encouraging compliance with management's directives. So the last two are really focused on the efficiency of the company's operation with respect to financial reporting and transactions. As I pointed out, management has the responsibility for internal controls. And again, auditors can only provide reasonable but not absolute assurance about internal controls. So the same reason we talked about with respect to the opinion that they give. They don't look at 100% of the items. So they can say it's absolutely perfect, you know, there are no problems. It's a reasonable assurance, just as the type of insurance that we present with respect to the financial statements. No internal control system is foolproof because there's collusion, right? There's the possibility of collusion. And you can't test for that. Right? The only thing you can do is design internal controls to ensure that you have the proper safeguards, the proper segregation of duties. But if the two or more employees decide that they're going to get together to circumvent the internal controls, it's going to be hard to detect that. As I pointed out, management is required to issue a report. This is a different requirement prior to SOX. Management did not have to issue a report. But now management is responsible for issuing a report, and that's in compliance with Section 404 of the Sarbanes-Oxley Act. In terms of the auditor's responsibility, the auditor is responsible to assess the risk of material misstatements. So if you think back to when we talked about the audit risk model, there were two components with regard to the risk of material misstatement: inherent risk and control risk. The auditor makes an assessment about both of those things because both of those risks impact the amount of evidence they're going to collect, the amount of detailed testing that they have to do. So the auditor has to assess internal controls from that perspective. The PCAOB requires the auditor to obtain an understanding of internal controls for every audit. So remember, the PCAOB is public, related to publicly held companies. Statement on auditing standards also require that, where in this case, auditors who are auditing public companies fall under the ruling of Standard 2, PCAOB Standard 2, okay, that they have to follow the standards according to the PCAOB. What they're looking for, again, is the reliability of financial reporting. They need to understand that they're controlled over transactions, right? They're controlled over shipments, that they need to understand that if they look at sales, that they have a reasonable assurance that only those sales are only recorded for those items that have actually been shipped in the current period. Right. So they expect to see, if they're doing a test of internal controls, to see that a shipment cannot, a sale cannot be recorded in the financial statements until there's a corresponding shipping document. So they would match shipping documents to sales recorded in the sales register. They're also concerned about fraudulent financial reporting and misappropriation of assets. When we talk about fraud, we'll talk about this a little bit more. Auditors are not responsible. They do not conduct a fraud audit. But they have to be aware of the risk of fraud or fraud risk factors in the conduct of a financial statement audit. So it's very different. They're not responsible for a fraud audit. If they find fraud, they have to respond to that. But that's not how they conduct their audit, to find fraud. Safeguarding of assets and compliance with laws and regulations. So you hear safeguarding of assets, we talk about segregation of duties, those types of things. Physical controls over assets to ensure that not everybody has access to the company's checkbook. If it's a manufacturing company, not anybody can walk in to the warehouse and just walk out with goods, that there are controls in place. They also, in terms of classes of transactions, what they're looking for is input, output, and processing controls. what kind of controls over input, what controls are in existence for processing of transactions, and the subsequent output of those transactions. Again, remember the audit risk model, control risk, right, has a inverse relationship to plan detection, evidence collection. So the higher your control risk, the lower your plan detection risk, the more evidence you're going to collect. So if you have high control risk, you want to keep your plan detection risk low, so you're going to have to capture or gather greater evidence. So again, and control risk is just one component of the risk of material misstatement. So never far away from management assertions. It's a good way to also think about the internal controls, testing of internal controls. So what you're asking, the questions you're asking, so these are not, you're not necessarily applying these to balance sheet accounts, or what you're looking at is the controls over transactions, right? That's what you're concerned with. What kind of controls exist over transactions? What kind of controls exist over assets? So you're looking at the process. So are the processes and records right? That would be existence, occurrence, and validity. And basically what the auditor is asking is, are the recorded transactions real? Did they actually occur? Are they properly dated? Rights and obligations. Do the transactions or assets belong to the organization? Accuracy and valuations. Are the events that occurred recorded at the right value? And then completeness. Are all the events that occurred recorded in the accounting information system, and are all the information fields, i.e. no blanks, recorded? So you want to make sure, for example, that you have a sale with the amount of the sale recorded, or the customer that you made that sale to. So you look for controls over the input, output, and processing of transactions. So now that you know that the records are right, what about authorization? Who has authorization? Is authorization properly segregated from custody of assets, for example? So are all events and information authorized? So for example, with accounts receivable, or sales, I'm sorry, with sales, we know that we want to have upfront some kind of credit limit policy. So we want to make sure that we're not selling goods to, one, unauthorized customers, and that, and if we are selling goods to, when we are selling goods to authorized customers, that those customers haven't exceeded their credit limit, or that they're not, they don't have an outstanding balance that is over the company's limit, over 90 days or something to that effect, right? So we want to make sure that there's authorization transactions are being authorized before they actually happen. So sort of like a second set of eyes. Are all authorizations recorded? So again, from an audit perspective, we need to see proof, right? So something, a sign-off, initials, or in a information system environment, that that person who has access, let's say the credit manager, that we see that only the credit manager has the ability to go in and authorize transactions, and we look for their signature or indication that they've approved the transactions, that they've released them, if they've released them. Assets and records are safeguarded. Can someone steal or destroy assets? So how do we protect our assets? Your warehouse, you should have controls over who goes in and out of the warehouse. You should have accountability. Not everyone should have access to move inventory. Not everyone should have access to cash or to checks, right? You want to see that there are controls. Those assets are physically controlled. Are all records kept? Can they be destroyed? Are they unchangeable? So you want to know that those assets are protected. They can't be destroyed or changed. So if you're in an information system environment, for instance, you're going to look to ensure that there are controls over who has access to update programs. and that there's a record, that there's some edit list or some type of record to show if there's been any change, that the system automatically produces if there's been a change to the programs or software. Okay. I'm not sure how many of you have heard of COSO before, but the COSO framework is pretty standard framework that is used by companies for internal controls. So there are some extensions of COSO, and some companies, especially companies who are very highly automated, and so they have enterprise-wide systems like SAP or Oracle, so they'll have an extension of COSO because it covers in more detail the information technology environment. But for our purposes when discussing internal controls for this class, we're going to focus on the accounting controls, controls over the accounting financial reporting process. So the components, there are five components of internal control under COSO. And as I said, it's a widely established, widely accepted, used framework. Control environment, risk assessment, control activities, information and communication, and then monitoring. So those are the four components of internal controls that companies are expected to have controls addressing each of these various components. So the control environment deals with the integrity and ethical values of management. What kind of tone are you setting for your employees? What message are you sending to the employees? So, for example, when I worked as an internal auditor, the company that I worked for, we had our internal controls were called the Red Book. It was and continues to be an international company, right? A U.S.-based company with international locations. So we had worldwide operations. Every single unit followed the Red Book. It didn't matter what they had at their place, at their location. At a minimum, they had to adhere to the controls in the Red Book. That was management's way of communicating to the employees and other business units, this is our expectation in terms of a control environment. We expect you to follow this. If you want to add controls on top of that, that's fine. But at a minimum, you have to follow the Red Book. Commitment to competence. So you want to know that management is instilling this in their employees by the message that they're sending. The board of directors or audit committee participation. Again, after Sarbanes-Oxley, the audit committee took on an expanded role and responsibility. They have oversight over the financial reporting process, which includes internal controls. Reporting of internal controls. So they have to be involved in this process. Management philosophy and operating style. Organizational structure. What kind of HR practices and policies exist and how are those communicated to employees? So it's the overall tone at the top. Risk assessment. Just as auditors are in planning the audit, right, they plan it from a risk-based approach, so they conduct a risk assessment of the company. Management should likewise do the same thing with respect to internal controls. You have to understand where your risk is and then identify what controls are in place to address that risk or what controls should be in place to address that risk. Likewise, when an auditor does control risk assessment, that's what they're looking at. They're trying to identify where's the risk. And then how is that risk addressed? Are there effective controls in place to address the risk? So what auditor is going to look for is to ensure that management is addressing the risk that they've identified. And what happened after Sarbanes-Oxley was passed, what you found was a lot of corporations were caught off guard. Because while they did have internal controls, what they realized is that they really, it was kind of loose in most cases. I mean, not all companies, but a lot of companies struggle with that because they never really took the time to go back and reevaluate controls. SOX put on a whole new level of requirement for companies to document. They hadn't documented it. So you had companies whose systems changed. They moved from legacy systems to these ERP systems, but they never really documented the change in internal control,
right.
or even took notice of whether or not internal controls needed to change because they had a different environment. So a big cost to companies was really going through this documentation process in terms of what their controls were like. And a part of that is assessing the risk to make sure that you understand where your risk is, because your risk changes if you move from legacy systems to ERP systems. Your risk changes if you're running legacy systems alongside ERP systems. Right? The more you have human intervention, the greater your risk is. You increase your risk. So you have to know where your risk is as an organization to be able to effectively design internal controls to address that risk. So the things that should be done is identify factors that may increase risk, estimate the significance of the risk. So the thing is, you don't want to develop an internal control system that's cost prohibitive, which is why the risk assessment process is so important. Assess the likelihood of the risk occurring and then determine what necessary actions have to be taken to manage that risk. As I pointed out, this risk assessment is done by managers, but it's closely related to the auditor's risk assessment, because the auditor, when they're assessing internal controls, is going to be looking at this. Yes, did someone? In terms of control activities, these are the activities that you expect to see in place to address the risk. These are the controls. So there are five different types of control activities. You want to ensure that the company has an adequate separation of duties or segregation of duties, right? So you want to make sure that a person who has custody of the asset is not in a position to steal the asset and then cover up the theft. So you don't want that person to have access to recordings if you have custody. So really what you want to do is make sure that those responsibilities are separated, because you want to be able to detect whether or not somebody's stealing or not stealing. So imagine if you had somebody who has access to inventory, and they can also update the inventory record. So they could walk out of the warehouse with inventory, go into the books and records, and change the inventory amount, and so the inventory was never there. So you want to separate those responsibilities. You want to ensure that there's a proper authorization of transactions and activities. So, for example, as I gave in an earlier example, that credit authorization takes place before items are shipped. Why is that important? Why does it matter when you authorize credit? Okay, spring break hasn't started. Just kind of guess. Why would that be important? Why do you have to have credit rating? Right, you want to have some level before you ship your, because once it's gone, right? What are you going to do, track the client down and the customer down and go back and get your stuff? Doesn't work that way. You can't repossess goods and services, right? So you want to make sure that, because what are you trying to do? What happens if a customer can't pay? What does that do to the business? What's affected? I heard AR. What else? Bad debts, right? So now you've created bad debts. You're out of goods, right? So you had a decrease in an asset with no corresponding increase in an asset. There's no give and take anymore. So you want to minimize your risk of selling to a customer that won't pay you or can't pay you. So that's why that's important, that you do credit authorizations, that you do credit checks. Right? You're trying to minimize your risk of loss. Ensure that there are adequate documents and records. So, for example, pre-numbered shipping documents, pre-numbered sales invoices, pre-numbered purchase orders, right? Because that creates, remember, part of the assertions is completeness. It's a way to check that you have a complete all of the transactions that should be recorded have been recorded. You want to make sure that documents are generated at the time of transaction. Why would that be important? Why is it important to generate a shipping document at the time you ship it versus a couple of days later? Well, I'm sorry? Well, revenue recognition, what else? Yeah. Well, you don't want them making up documents, right?
So that's why you have to.
Right, so that's for the pre-number, right? You want to be able to account for it, so you want to know. But why is it important to generate a document at the time of that transaction occurring? Right, law. Right? What happens if it doesn't get recorded? Were you going to say something? Well, it's efficiency. Right. Right. It keeps your information up to date. And obviously, in an automated environment, that's like a no-brainer. Right? It happens. So what you want to do is you ensure that you record. Because what happens, maybe it doesn't matter in the middle of the month, but it matters at the end of the month. Because it's going to impact your revenue recognition, right? If we're talking about shipping documents, if you haven't recorded the shipment, that means you haven't recorded the sale necessarily, right? Because the shipment triggers the sale. You want to make sure that there's physical controls over assets and records, so things you see. And remember, information is an asset. A company's financial information is an asset. So it is important to have controls over those things. So those things are password protected. Not every, or you're controlling about who should have access to that information. Think of confidentiality issues with employees. So controls over HR information and who has access to that information. Because if that information is leaked, a company faces litigation, right? That can create huge problems. If customer information is stolen or released or hacked into, that creates reputational issues for the company, litigation issues for the company. It could possibly lose customers who they believe, you know, if a customer believes that their credit card information isn't safe or their personal information isn't kept confidential, they're not going to want to do business. Would you go back and do business with somebody who's lost all your information, or your information was hacked into and now your social security is out there, your credit card numbers are out there? You're not going to be real comfortable dealing with that company anymore. 9 times out of 10, you'll stop, unless you absolutely have no choice, you'll stop doing business with that company. Independent checks on performance, and this is what we look at in terms of doing reconciliations, bank reconciliations, reconciling master files to the general ledger, those types of things. If somebody's checking to make sure that if all sales have to be approved by the credit manager, that that's actually happening, that somebody is checking to see it. That happens on a periodic basis. With respect to segregation of duties, are a huge, huge internal control. If there's not a proper segregation of duties, that is going to be a significant weakness in internal control, depending on where the segregation of duties issue occurs. Okay. So the things that you want to see at a minimum are custody of assets from accounting. So the person who has custody of the asset cannot update the accounting records. Authorization of transactions from the custody of the related asset. Operational responsibility from record-keeping responsibility. We're not going to get into this, but because we're not covering technology, information technology in this course, but IT duties, information technology duties from user department. The overall objective of separation of duties is you want to prevent a person or persons from perpetrating a fraud and covering it up, that's your big objective, right? Because that's what really, if it's an error, you know, people aren't just, you know, going to steal an asset and say, "Ooh, I made a mistake. I didn't mean to take it," right? So you're really concerned about people being able to create an irregularity or fraud and then covering it up. So you want to make sure that those duties are properly segregated. The final two components of the COSO model is information and communication and then monitoring. And information and communication, you're dealing with an accounting information system, and you want to make sure the management should have controls in place to make sure that there are input controls, processing controls, and output controls. So controls over those three aspects of the information process, information system, right? You input things, and so for example, you want to have controls over the input of customer orders. You want to have control over the input of purchase orders, right? Because a purchase order creates a contract if you send it out to a vendor. It's a contract between you and that vendor. You want to have controls. You want to make sure that those things are processed. Once they're input into the system, that they're following the proper process, whatever processing controls that management or processing procedures that management has in place. So for example, if there's a control that says, for all customer orders that are input, right, there has to be an approved customer order or customer number associated with that. So you're going to want to see, as an auditor, that there are controls in place, that customer order cannot be processed if it's not matched against an approved customer order. Or things like if there's a control that says all sales to customers who have an outstanding balance greater than 90 days have to be held up in a suspense file, can't be processed. You want to see that those things are happening, right? That so you would look, for example, customers who have receivables over 90 days old to ensure that there were no shipments of goods. And if there were, that they were properly approved or authorized. So your overall objective here, obviously, is to have accountability over your related assets. And then monitoring activity deals with management's assessment, periodic assessment. So that's when the internal audit groups come in. So internal audit groups are monitoring. If you're a manufacturing facility, you might have quality control groups that come in and monitor the process. Most companies will have an IT audit group looking at the IT controls, because a lot of times auditors, just based on their training, are not qualified to really assess information technology controls. So it really depends. But that's just management's periodic assessment of whether or not internal controls are being adhered to as prescribed by management. So the process for understanding internal controls is summarized as you, one, as an auditor, obtain an understanding of internal control design and operation. So that's what you're doing in your planning phase. That's how you're going to be able to understand what the company's control environment is. And once you do that, you assess control risk. That's the portion of the audit risk model. Then design, based on your understanding of the control risk, design and perform tests of controls. Because here you're only gaining an understanding, and you're based on that understanding, you're assessing risk. Now you have to test it. And it could be that you test this in phase three and find out that your assessment in phase two was incorrect. So you would have to revise your assessment, which is going to impact phase four. So you're not going to say, I'm going to test them. I'm going to revise my assessment and test some more controls. No. You're going to revise your assessment and do some more detailed testing. You increase your detailed testing, which is phase four. Decide your planned detection risk and then the amount of substantive tests that you're going to perform. And substantive tests are detailed tests of account balances and transactions. Once you have assessed it during the evaluating internal control procedures, you're going to update your previous experience. That's how you evaluate it. talk to client personnel to determine whether or not anything new has happened, look at documents and records, look at, observe the entity's activities and operations, so you physically observe, you can do, and you're going to also do walkthroughs of the accounting system to ensure, because your goal here is to ensure that internal controls are operating the way they're described. Because your risk assessment is based on your understanding from discussions with management about how internal controls work. We talked about this when we talked about the audit risk model, but basically you're going to assess whether the financial statements are auditable. In other words, can you rely on internal controls? Because if you can't rely on internal controls, you have, as an auditor, have to decide how bad are they, and is it possible for you to even audit the company, right, if the internal controls are that bad? How much evidence can you possibly look at? Determine what your assessed control risk is, and then using a control matrix, assess what control risk is. This is what you did with your Pinnacle assignment, right? You had to identify, you were given controls, and you had to identify what were considered controls, what were considered deficiencies, and then given those deficiencies and given the internal controls that were in place, what kind of risk, what was your assessed risk? Just quickly, and we'll talk about this more when we talk about audit reports later in the semester, but with respect to internal controls, you can have control deficiencies, significant deficiencies, and material weaknesses. If a control deficiency becomes a significant deficiency, you have to decide whether or not it will result in a material weakness. Is that the likelihood that it will result in a material weakness? And if it results in a material weakness, that is a reportable item, right? In the report, and then a report on internal controls, that could lead to an adverse a report over internal controls. A control deficiency just means that there's either a design issue or an operational issue. A design issue means that the control is not properly designed or it's missing. An operational issue is the control is in place, but it's not operating as designed. Or the person responsible for it is not qualified. Right, so you have two types of deficiencies. You then have to decide whether or not those control deficiencies rise to a level of a significant deficiency. So it's more than a remote likelihood that one or more control deficiencies will result in a material misstatement. So at this point, when you're evaluating, is this significant? Can it lead to a material misstatement? And then you also decide, does it lead to a material misstatement? So in other words, does this significant deficiency rise to the point where you will not be able to prevent or detect an error or irregularity? And then you have to also look at, well, where is it occurring? Okay, and what's the impact on the financial statements? Because remember, the goal of internal, you cannot look at internal controls separately from, the whole point of it is that you're looking at the reliability of the financial statements. So is this weakness or deficiency significant enough that it would result in a material weakness in the financial statements? And you identify those deficiencies and weaknesses by looking at what are the existing controls. Obviously, you have to identify what the existing control is and what key controls are missing. Right? So a key control obviously would be a control that would prevent or detect an error or irregularity. Okay? So a company could have a control, but that control is not a key control because it is not in itself, by itself, able to prevent or detect an error. Consider the possibility of compensating controls. And compensating controls are, okay, we have controls, but there will be another way that management would catch it. If there's a control deficiency, management has other things in place. So, for example, you would like to see, let's say, that all sales are approved by the all sales are approved by the credit manager for customers who are over 90 days, right? Over 90 days outstanding. If you're in a manual environment, that might, maybe the you know, that's not timely. So you would look for it, but if the manager, if there's a review on a weekly basis, right, that looks at all sales to see and then matches it, then it there's some control in place. So now you have to look at, well, how timely is that? What's the likelihood that those goods are shipped and that management won't be able to recover? So you look, recover the goods if they make a sale to a customer who's incapable of paying. So compensating controls aren't perfect controls, and they might, because they might not be as timely in terms of preventing or detecting, in terms of preventing, but they might be controls in place to detect an error. Decide whether there's a significant deficiency or material weakness, and then what the potential misstatement could be. What impact does it have on the financial statement? I already talked about this. In terms of communications, the audit committee is responsible. Auditors would report internal control deficiencies and weaknesses to the audit committee. Auditors will issue management letters, which just basically show, for example, if you don't have significant deficiencies or material weaknesses, obviously, it might be operational efficiency or effectiveness that the auditor notes throughout the audit, and so they're making management aware of it. Section 404, I already talked about, the management has to give an opinion, and the auditors have to give an opinion over internal controls. So just to summarize the steps in your internal control analysis as an auditor, look at each process one at a time. So there's several, again, we go, we audit based on expenditure cycle, the revenue cycle, but within each of those, so we audit on a cycle approach, and within each of those cycles, you have a process, right? So for example, revenue cycle, there's the order, customer order process. There is the credit approval process. There's the shipment process. There's the cash collection process, right? There's the updating of accounts receivable and the allowance for doubtful accounts. There's sales returns and allowances. So within each of these cycles, you have various processes that happen. As an auditor, you want to look at the revenue cycle, not just on the whole, but look at the processes within the revenue cycle. Identify those situations that result in threats or risk. What are the threats to an effective system of internal control? And we talked about the general assertion. So each threat, then what controls can be implemented to prevent or detect or correct the errors? And just a quick definition, a preventive control is obviously what you want to have in place because it prevents it from happening. It's real time. So you want to, a preventive control would be that no, a shipment cannot occur without the approval of the sales manager. I'm sorry, not sales manager, credit manager. So it would be physically no paper. If you're in a real-time system, nothing, no shipping documents would be generated until the credit manager approves it. Right? So that prevents it from happening. Detective control finds it after it has occurred. So detective control might be, you know, an edit list or going or some type of warning or report going to the credit manager saying that these are all of the sales that were recorded today, that were processed today, but before they've been shipped. Corrective control fixes what's found. You have a detective control, identifies it, the corrective control fixes it so it doesn't happen again. Talked about 404 reporting and the various types of opinions. So, as I said, we'll talk more about this when we talk about audit reports, but you can issue an unqualified opinion on internal controls, an adverse opinion, or a qualification or disclaimer. Unqualified, no material weaknesses. An adverse opinion, one or more material weaknesses. And then a scope limitation, meaning that you were unable to, because the client didn't have records, or the system was such that you could not audit this, that system of internal control related to a particular area, you would issue a qualified or a disclaimer opinion. But we'll talk more about these when we talk about reports.